Hi everyone, it's Peter Schiff and it is Thursday, June 10th, 2010. Well, we had a huge update in the U.S. stock market today. I think the Dow was up about 270 points. The dollar had a big down day today. The dollar index was down about a full percentage point. It was particularly weak against the commodity currencies like the Australia and New Zealand dollar, partially because we had some economic news coming from down under. We had Australian unemployment rate dropping to 5.2%, considerably better than ours. And New Zealand raised interest rates for the first time in a couple of years, I think, from 2.5% to 2.75%. And I'm sure there are many more rate hikes that will be coming soon. So both the Aussie and the Kiwi dollars gained, I think, 2.5% on the day. Gold gave back about $15. Oil prices continued their recent surge up over a dollar today. We're back over 75.5 per barrel, and I think we are headed much, much higher in oil prices, as I explained in my last video blog related to the BP spill. I wanted to talk a little bit more today, though, about Ben Bernanke's testimony yesterday in front of the House. And of course, you know, I always try to take a look at what he's saying, not because I think you know, anything he says has any merit. It's only because I like to hear what Congress is hearing, and if anything, you use Ben Bernanke as a contrarian indicator, because pretty much everything he says, you can bet that the opposite will in fact happen. And of course, what Bernanke assured Congress was that there would not be a double dip recession, no chance of that, the economy was growing, and that inflation was contained, it was not a problem. Now, of course, he's wrong on both counts. One of the most interesting things, I think, about the testimony was a Q&A where he was asked about gold and if he was worried about the increase in the price of gold. And Ben Bernanke actually said that he was perplexed by the increase in the price of gold, because after all, there's no inflation, so why is gold going up? He pointed out that other commodities, you know, like copper or oil, they were falling. And so that indicated that inflation wasn't a problem. And also he pointed to the spread between the tips and regular treasuries or the long-term yield, all as evidence of low inflation expectations. So he didn't understand why gold was going up. He thought maybe it was because of uncertainty, because there was a lot of uncertainty in the stock market. And so maybe the price of gold was going up. But, you know, think about that. I mean, if you're uncertain, why buy gold? I mean, is there any certainty to the price of gold? I mean, just because you think stocks might go down, you just don't go and buy gold. I mean, if you really were just uncertain, you'd buy dollars. You'd put your money in the bank. You wouldn't want to buy anything if you were uncertain. The reality is gold is going up because people are certain of one thing, and that there's a lot of inflation coming, and that's why they're buying gold. The reason that commodities are falling is because people are concerned about the double dip recession. People see the economic tea leaves. They know the economies are weakening. You see, there's a difference. Maybe Ben Bernanke doesn't understand this, between gold and other commodities. These cyclical commodities that have to do with economic growth, they're falling. But gold, which is a harbinger of inflation, is rising. So what's happening with the price of gold and other commodities is it is proving that Ben Bernanke is wrong on both of his assumptions. It proves that the economy is weakening and will probably go back into recession, and that inflation is a problem. And the reason that Ben Bernanke is perplexed by something that's actually so simple, it's either because he knows nothing about economics and money and inflation, or he's just a liar. You know, either way, it doesn't look good to have the Fed chairman who's a liar or incompetent. Also, Ben Bernanke did correctly warn that we would have problems from these out-of-control deficits, and that if we didn't do something, it would be a major problem. Of course, he also said that we shouldn't do anything about it now, that it's too early to cut government spending. Well, if we continue to spend, then the deficit problem that he's warning about is actually getting worse. If he's concerned about it, why is he encouraging Congress to worsen the problem? See, he thinks, well, if we cut spending now, that's going to derail the recovery. There is no recovery to derail. And the reason the economy is not recovering is because of all this government spending, because all this government regulation that's interfered with the free market. Not only do we have to cut spending now to head off the imploding time bomb with the debt, but we have to cut spending now so that the economy can grow. That's another thing that the Fed chairman doesn't understand. Now, let me move for a minute from the Fed chairman to Obama in Congress and the BP oil spill. And, you know, as bad as that oil spill is, and don't get me wrong, this is a terrible environmental accident, and it's bad. But as always, the government's reaction has the potential of being even worse, doing even more damage to our economy than the spill itself. I mean, first of all, I mentioned last time, the six-month moratorium on offshore drilling is wrong. All right, we shouldn't have called that, but we did. Okay. Now, what the Obama administration is trying to do is hold BP responsible, make them pay for all the salaries of all the laid-off workers that are out of work because of his moratorium. Now, the moratorium is not BP's fault. The spill is. The cost of cleaning it up, that's on them. Economic damages caused by their spill, that's on them, and they are paying those claims. But lost wages from people who are out of work because the Obama administration chose to have a six-month moratorium, there is no legal principle under which you can hold BP responsible for those costs. I mean, sure, BP's accident might have been the catalyst for the moratorium, but the moratorium is designed to prevent other oil companies from having spills. You can't hold BP responsible for what other oil companies may or may not do. And if this moratorium prevents other oil companies from spilling oil, why should BP have to pick up the tab for that? It is sheer nonsense. But the fact that we are threatening them with this type of cost, this is very damaging to our reputation as a capitalist economy, as an economy that goes by the rule of law. Speaking about the rule of law, what about the ex post facto law that Congress is trying to pass on liability? You know, Congress decided in 1990 to pass a bill that I think was misguided, and again, they shouldn't have passed it, regarding oil pollution. And what it did was cap the damages that oil companies have to pay for economic damages if there's a spill offshore. And this was done deliberately to encourage offshore drilling, so that offshore drilling would happen because people wouldn't be too worried about the liability because the government capped it. And of course, the moral hazard of this bill was that we had a lot more offshore drilling than we might otherwise have had the drillers had to worry about more liability. Now, to its credit, BP has said that it's not going to hide behind this law, which it legally has a right to do. It has said that it's going to pay all legitimate claims. But despite that, Congress now wants to repeal that bill retroactively so that the damage is unlimited, or maybe they're talking about $10 billion. Well, how do you repeal a law retroactively when ex post facto laws are unconstitutional? If they pass the law and BP and other companies are operating in the Gulf based on that law, we have assured them that the U.S. government is capping their liability, their economic liability, at $75 million. Then they have an accident, and then we go back and say, we're going to remove that law retroactively, and now your liability is unlimited. You cannot do that. You know, you have to be a nation of laws. Even if the law was wrong, and I think the law was wrong, it was the law. BP relied on it. You can't pull the rug out from under them. What kind of message are we sending to businesses, American businesses, foreign businesses that want to operate in this country? That you can't count on the law. That politicians can do whatever they want. They can change the rules of the game in the middle of the game. They can pull the rug out from under you. They can make a commitment and then they can break it. That laws do not count. That we are not a nation of laws. We are a nation of men. That there is no respect for private property in the United States. You know, we invest a lot internationally at my company. And whenever people invest internationally, everybody always talks about, you know, a political risk. You know, what is the political risk when you invest in foreign countries? Well, maybe their governments won't abide by the rule of law. Maybe you'll have some government that'll just seize private property, that'll take your assets, you know, without due process. Well, that's what this amounts to. That's what Congress is trying to do with BP. Sure, as I said, the spill was bad. And if they were grossly negligent, if this was not just an accident, if this was negligence, then we don't have to worry because that $75 million limit doesn't apply. But if it was just an accident, we cannot treat companies the way the U.S. government is treating BP. It's not about kicking ass, President Obama. It's about abiding by the law, by being a country of laws, not a country of men, where people want to invest, where the laws and the Constitution are respected, not just for Americans, but for any foreign company doing business on our shores. Anyway, take care, everybody.